This is a segment of the up-and-coming The Whole Chessboard video. I hope you enjoy. We know from the Holy Scriptures that the Nephilim existed in the past and were created from fallen watchers who descended upon man and married the daughters of the line of Cain to corrupt the seed of man and stop Yahushua HaMashiach from being born. While the possibility of Nephilim may sound delusional to many, if you took the time to search for them, you'll find the evidence all around you. You need to train your eye like finding mushrooms in the forest. It takes a bit of dedication first, but soon you'll see them everywhere. Review Mud Fossil University on YouTube and other mud fossil channels. Roger at Mud Fossil University has tested the remains of giant body parts from our past and points out the anatomy of the Nephilim throughout the earth. However, listen to Roger's explanation of the science only, as his theology is a bit lost in the Gnostic and Freemasonic writings. The creation of the Nephilim is written in the Book of Enoch, which was included in the scriptures until the papacy usurped God's laws and removed that book and other books and created a canonized or authorized version of the scriptures that we know as the Bible today. I have included the scriptures removed by the papacy in the library in the link in the description. These Nephilim mud fossils are stone, but not millions of years old. Invest a few days listening to Mud Fossil University and you'll understand that turning flesh to stone is a process that only takes a decade under the right conditions. This process is called nucleophilic substitution, a process that can happen from a flood, especially a world flood, in less than a decade. And the world flood created stone giants all over the land and now sea. Nephilim also exist today through the bloodlines, and while they may not be giants, they are part of the fallen watcher bloodlines, or they believe they are. And there are stories being released about Nephilim. Understanding that these beings were real and are celebrated today by many cultures is a valuable tool to understanding this realm. For example, in the Greek pantheon, Hercules was a Nephilim story. Perseus was a Nephilim story. Egypt's Imhotep was a Nephilim story. Romans Romulus and Remus were Nephilim stories. African Nitikuma was a Nephilim story. Philippine Mayari was a Nephilim story. Hindu Drona was a Nephilim story. Norse Sigi was a Nephilim story. Celtic Cú Chulainn was a Nephilim story. Maui or Maori Maui was a Nephilim story. Gilgamesh was a Nephilim story. And many of these stories have been bastardized into the superhero stories of today.
Fuck! Yes! We know each other! He's a friend from work!
Batman, created by Bob Kane and Bill Finger in 1939, was my comic of choice. And did you know that Batman's grandfather established Skull and Bones in the DC world, and Bruce Wayne attended Yale, the home of Skull and Bones?
That is Bruce Wayne's grandfather, Mrs. Cooper?
His great-grandfather.
I understand he was tapped for Skull and Bones.
Tapped for it? Sir, he founded Skull and Bones.
The worship of these superheroes is direct, not indirect, worship of these Nephilim of the past. And just because you put a different name to them does not mean they are now different beings. It is understandable to ignore this information, because your worldview will shift by acknowledging it. However, it is actually delusional to ignore the evidence and choose to live in ignorance than it is to understand the reality we are in, accept the evidence, and act accordingly. I speculate that the end goal is to release the ability to turn man into something like these ancient beings, like Nimrod, who began to become a giant, or Gibberim from the Babylon history. Our hubris will lead us to believe we deserve this gift of corruption. After the flood, giants roamed the earth, but these giants have a different name than the antediluvian giants. Where the pre-flood giants were called Nephilim, the post-flood giants were called Rephaim. There are a few theories on how the Rephaim came to be, so let's take a quick look at them. The first theory is a second incursion where the fallen came to the daughters of man, again creating a new line of giants. The second is an epigenetic function. Epigenetics is the study of how cells control gene activity without changing the DNA sequence. The third is that giants survived the flood, either by boat or by going underground. These are all discussed regularly, and you can find their reasonings simply by searching. People who talk about these topics are Tom Horn, Stephen Quayle, Rob Skiba, Dr. Judge Burton, Timothy Alberino, Dr. Michael Heiser, Dr. Sanger, and the Fall Brothers. All of these scholars turn to scripture first and then postulate their theories. However, I have a different theory on the resurgence of giants, and it's relevant to our understanding of the human body today. It is eloquent and maintains biblical integrity that all Nephilim died in the flood. God left the Hebrews roaming the Sea of Reeds for 40 years, and some of the tribes of Canaan had not fully condemned themselves through enough sin to warrant removal. Remember, God is just. We know that the tribes of Canaan sacrificed to their gods, but why keep doing this horrible thing if it doesn't produce obvious, visual, and undeniable results? It has to be creating an addiction to power and control. Furthermore, it would manufacture an arms race against the other tribes in the lands. In order to build a legion of mighty men, there would have to be rewards of prestige within the tribes. And by participating, you would become a noble within the community, like a knight in a monarchy. By participating and having your family participate, you can grow and prosper. The king of the land would get the most benefit, and his sons becoming the largest through participation of worship to Moloch and Baal. In order to commit great sin to warrant your execution by God, these tribes sacrificed their babies and aborted children to their idols and fed the blood and raw meat to their growing children. This practice gave these children infusions of growth factor hormones. On top of that, the sins of sexual deviancy creating the children, and then the abortion and ingestion of the children of the tribes, fulfilled their requirements for God to wipe them from the earth. It doesn't explain blue-tinged skin or red hair, which could be a metal toxicity, but this practice and the epigenetic markers explain much of the possible creation of Rephaim. The fallen messengers all learned the lesson of direct sin in the antediluvian times. They must let man corrupt themselves and damn themselves to hell. And that is just what the Rephaim are, corruption to the extreme. And this is how we will see them again, sometime after disclosure and during the tribulation. What is it that hath been? The same thing that shall be. What is it that hath been done? The same that shall be done. Nothing under the sun is new, neither is any man able to say, behold, this is new, for it hath already gone before the ages that were before us. King Solomon, the rundown of our reality.